It's 1982 during a cold winter in Antarctica when an isolated American research station is infiltrated by a recently thawed out alien organism that can absorb other living organisms and create perfect copies which flawlessly imitate the behavior of its victim. Who in your station is an alien and how can you survive this situation? I'm going to explain how you can beat the thing. By breaking down the story, the mistakes made, and what you should do to defeat the shape-shifting extraterrestrial organism in the 1982 movie titled The Thing. Time out. I want to quickly thank the kind people that take the time to like and comment on my videos. Your likes and comments really help with the YouTube algorithm and growing the channel. Okay, I just need 10 seconds to quickly advertise my online store to you, then I'll start the video. Check out MeBomber.com for the funniest clothing on the internet. MeBomber is sure to get you laughs and compliments. MeBomber makes a great novelty gift for friends and family. And check out my Patreon if you want to directly show your support. Links in the description. Alright, let's start the video. The movie begins with a UFO flying towards the Earth. Two Norwegian guys in a helicopter are chasing after, shooting at, and trying to drop explosives on a sled dog. The sled dog reaches an American research station, and its occupants greet the seemingly innocent dog. The Norwegian men in a helicopter land, and one of them accidentally drops a grenade he was trying to throw at the sled dog, thus blowing himself and the helicopter up. The surviving Norwegian man from a distance yells at the Americans to get away from the dog, but they don't understand his language, thus forcing him to fire at the dog and accidentally shoot an American. Gary, the station commander, retaliates by shooting the Norwegian man in the head. The Americans welcome the sled dog into their base and allow it to roam around freely. RJ, the pilot, and Dr. Copper take a helicopter to the Norwegian research station to report to them what just happened with their team member that was killed. RJ and Dr. Copper arrive at the Norwegian station and find everything destroyed and everybody dead. While investigating, they stumbled upon and brought back to their home base a burnt corpse that does not look completely human. They perform an autopsy on the corpse and discover that internally the organs seem to be those of a normal human. The mystery sled dog is placed in a kennel with other dogs after being allowed to roam around the station freely for most of the day. The mystery dog peels back its skin and sprouts spider-like legs and tentacles all over its body. It's an alien. People run to the kennel after hearing loud crying from the dogs and find the transformed alien in the process of absorbing the other canines. Gunshots don't work, so they burn the alien with a flamethrower, which proves to be successful. They perform an autopsy on the alien corpse, find body parts of other animals and humans inside of it, and Dr. Blair hypothesizes that this organism has the ability to absorb and perfectly replicate whatever biological organism that it kills. Alright, thanks to Blair's autopsy, they now know what this parasitic creature is, so there's no longer any excuse for stupid behavior that benefits the alien. The alien dog was allowed to freely roam the station for many hours, meaning it's had countless opportunities to replicate animals and humans that were separated from the group. So, there's a high probability that there's more alien clones in the station. And the more people decide to keep separating from the group to do their own thing, the more replication opportunities the alien continues to have. From this point on, wandering off for any reason should be prohibited. This will block all opportunities that the alien would have to secretly replicate more people until you can discover a way to test or identify aliens from humans. Back to the story. The Americans go over the Norwegian researchers' data for information on the alien and stumble upon the location of a spacecraft that the foreigners found. RJ, Dr. Copper, and Vance take a helicopter to investigate the spacecraft site, and they estimate that the ice it was buried in is at least 100,000 years old. Okay, so three people separating from the station to explore the spacecraft site is providing the alien with more replication opportunities. At the very least, to help safeguard against further alien infiltration, precautions must be taken to provide the exploration group with cameras to video document their every action while outside the station. Upon their return, the exploration group should be quarantined until their video footage is reviewed. Any suspicious or missing periods of time in their video footage should categorize the person as a potential alien until proven otherwise. Back to the story. The exploration group returns to the station to discuss what they saw, and they hypothesize that the dead Norwegians accidentally thawed out the frozen alien which crash-landed on our planet thousands of years ago. Dr. Blair runs a computer program that estimates it will take 3 years for the alien to infect the entire world population if it escapes this isolated Antarctic research station and manages to reach a populated, civilized area. The fate of humanity depends on you figuring out a way to identify an alien from a human before everyone in the station is replicated. needed. So unorthodox, unethical, and inhumane methods of testing should be on the table when the stakes are this high. At this point, all you know for sure is that fire can actually damage or cause the alien to react adversely. Shoot a flamethrower at the foot of every team member on this station and observe if someone exhibits any non-human reactions. A second or third degree burn on a single foot is treatable, non-fatal, and a small price to pay to save the lives of the remaining humans in the station and potentially the entire world. Back to the story. George and a guy named Windows carry the alien corpses out of the laboratory and into the storeroom. Greed and a desire to possibly win a Nobel Prize is what's motivating the station to store this evidence of alien life forms when they should be burning it. They don't have an airtight container to store the alien inside to help ensure that not a single extraterrestrial cell or molecule is able to potentially infect more humans. This is dangerous when you don't know the exact details of the alien's physiology or how little is necessary on a cellular level for the alien to take over other organisms. And you don't know what new diseases can develop by direct contact or breathing in extraterrestrial particles. Plus, the corpses are being stored in a dark storage room with no oversight. This might allow any living cells on the alien corpse, if any remain, to possibly reproduce until it forms another fully functional alien life form. You don't know what this alien is capable of, so you have to watch it. Back to the story. The moment the station member named Windows leaves George in the storage room by himself, a weird slime immediately starts leaking from the alien corpse. Windows comes back to the storage room and finds George dead and being taken over by the alien organism. Alien George runs away, but the station crew finds and surrounds it and then burns it to death. This is another easily preventable death if the station crew would just take my advice and stop separating from each other. The station crew finally does the smart thing and burns all the alien corpses and tissue samples. Dr. Blair is caught destroying the station's helicopter and radio system because he's paranoid about more crew members being aliens and the possibility that the alien may make it to civilization. The crew members subdue Dr. Blair and lock him in a tool shed to prevent any more acts of sabotage. Isolating Dr. Blair from the main group is a terrible idea that just makes him an easy target for the alien to replicate. The crew discusses Dr. Copper's blood test idea to identify the alien, which involves comparing new blood samples to previously taken blood samples of the station members. Crew members discover the blood storage has been destroyed, and paranoia of one another skyrockets. A man named Fuchs is by himself in a dark room, studying notes on the alien. The electricity in Fuchs's room goes out. He hears footsteps and grabs a candle to investigate the inside and outside of his building. Crew members find Fuchs's burnt corpse and hypothesize he burned himself to prevent his body from being taken over by the attacking alien. This is yet another easily preventable death if the crew would just take my advice and stop isolating and separating from each other. A man named Vance has a heart attack. Dr. Copper attempts to resuscitate Vance with a defibrillator, and the patient's stomach transforms into a mouth that bites off the doctor's hands. By this point in the story, the crew has seen the alien within a matter of seconds sprout hands to tear and grab things, grow tentacles to constrict and pierce through objects like butter, and develop multiple heads with sharp teeth to bite people. There is no excuse for the crew to not have figured out by now that you shouldn't get so close to one another that you are unable to react if a sudden alien transformation occurs. They should have mandated that everyone stays within eyesight of each other and at least 6 feet apart until they figure out how to identify aliens from humans. The alien Vance fully transforms and is burned to death by RJ. The crew reluctantly agrees to RJ's plan to identify the aliens among the group by tying everyone to a chair and introducing heat to a sample of their blood to look for any weird reactions, since the alien has been shown to respond poorly to fire. Allowing RJ to tie everyone up while he tests blood is a dangerous idea that makes everyone completely vulnerable to a possible alien attack. RJ has possibly spent the most time out of everyone, either by himself for various reasons or off exploring dangerous areas like the Norwegian base and the alien spacecraft site. So he's just as likely, if not more likely, to be an alien because of all the opportunities for replication that his behavior thus far has provided. What you should do is sit everyone at least 6 feet apart in a locked room with the rule that if anybody moves in their chair for any reason, they will be killed, alien or not. Then test the blood samples. Only aliens would have a reason to attempt moving from their chair, and everyone else can respond together to eliminate the threats instead of putting all their fates in the hands of one man. Back to the story. RJ ties everyone just inches away from each other to a couple chairs and a sofa. This is a terrible idea that would result in multiple deaths should a sudden alien transformation occur in the group and the other people are unable to move away. RJ heats up a wire with his flamethrower to burn their blood samples and test for a reaction. Palmer's blood reacts by jumping out of the petri dish once the heat is introduced. The alien Palmer immediately transforms platforms to try and break through the chair that it's tied to. The other tied up crew members can't get away from Palmer and scream for RJ to burn the alien before they are killed. RJ's flamethrower malfunctions and won't shoot. Alien Palmer quickly kills the crew member named Windows by chewing on his head. RJ finally manages to get his flamethrower to work and kills the alien Palmer. Windows begins to transform after being chewed to death by the alien Palmer, but RJ burns him before the transformation can complete. Everyone else in the room is proven to be a human, so they head over to test Dr. Blair in the shed that they locked him inside and discover that it's been broken open. They investigate the shed and find an underground tunnel with a spacecraft that the alien was building, using parts from the station's broken helicopter. Like I said earlier, locking Dr. Blair by himself inside a shed simply makes him an easy target for the alien. Everybody searches for the alien Dr. Blair when the electric generator is destroyed and power to the entire base has been turned off permanently. They are now all doomed to eventually freeze to death. At this moment, I was very upset that the characters did not learn their lesson from Dr. Blair sabotaging the helicopter and radio system earlier and left important resources or equipment like the electric generator still unsecured and unguarded. They should have initially split the station into two equal groups that are prohibited from allowing members to separate for any reason, so the alien does not have any chances to secretly replicate anyone else. Group 1 guards a single room filled with all the vital equipment and resources in the station, like their electric generator, radios, food supplies, etc. Group 2 is the exploration team that moves as a unit to execute any necessary investigation or retrieval missions. Back to the story. The remaining crew members come to the realization that they're all going to die since the electric generator has been destroyed, and that if the alien is allowed to freeze again, it will eventually be thawed out by future rescue teams and then go on another rampage that may result in it reaching civilization. The crew begins blowing up the station with dynamite to destroy the hidden alien or smoke the alien out of hiding. Station members separate once again to lay explosives around the base and are attacked by the alien. A giant alien bursts through the ground to attack RJ. RJ dives for a stick of dynamite and manages to blow up the giant alien. RJ and another station member named Childs are not sure if the other person is an alien, but sit in the snow together anyways and pass around a bottle of alcohol to drink until they freeze. In the end, I suspect Childs is an alien because there wasn't any cold breath coming out of his mouth like there was with RJ. Another crew member that wandered off named Knowles is still unaccounted for. The story hints that he likely fell victim to the alien, but we're not certain if he was part of the giant alien RJ killed at the end. Gary, who was replicated by the Dr. Blair alien, may or may not have been part of the giant alien that RJ blew up with the dynamite. And the Dr. Blair alien may or may not have been the same giant alien that RJ killed in the end. That means there's 4 or more possible aliens remaining to take over humanity. The incompetence of this station's crew would have doomed us all. That's the end of the movie. Let me know your thoughts and opinions in the comment section. I got more How to Beat and Why You Wouldn't Survive videos coming up for your favorite movies and TV shows, so stay tuned. Have a fantastic day and I'll see you on the next video.